Well, good afternoon. Really appreciate the work that the mayor and the sheriff and everybody here is doing. As you know, this isn't their first rodeo. We've had storms impacting the area in 16 and 17, and I think that they bring a lot of skill and experience to this. I recently reissued the executive order from yesterday declaring a state of emergency. Initially, we had done all the counties on the East Coast from Monroe to Nassau. We've now expanded that to cover all 67 Florida counties. And we did that just as a recognition that you have a forecast here that's had a high degree of uncertainty. There's arguments that you can make that it goes south across the state, then up in the Gulf of Mexico and affects Northwest Florida. There's arguments that people can make that it's gonna turn north before that. So we just wanna make sure everyone is in a posture to be able to protect their folks. I spoke with the president, been in contact with the Trump administration. We're going to get full support from the federal government, and I think that that's something that's very, very important. For folks in Florida, you see the uncertainty. I think the key thing is to, you know, have a plan and execute your plan and make preparations. We don't necessarily know the exact contours of this storm, but we know it's a serious storm, and we know it has a chance to really have significant impacts on the state of Florida. And so from Monroe County all the way north to Jacksonville, Duval, Nassau, make sure that you take the proper precautions. If you prepare and then the storm ends up taking a different direction, you're not going to be any worse for that. But if you don't prepare and then you have a significant impact, you know, that's going to be something that you're going to regret. If you are in an area that gets impacted, just prepare to lose power. You know, we're working with some of the utilities. I've been in contact consistently with Florida Power and Light. I was able to speak to the JEA president. You know, we think it's very important for the state's recovery efforts that there's a plan in place for the utilities to, you know, work really quickly to restore power. And I think all of the ones we've been talking to agree with that. But even if you do that as good as can be expected, there's still going to be a loss of power if you get impacted by a storm of this magnitude. So take precautions of that. Be prepared with food, water, medicine for 7 days. I was down in Miami at the National Hurricane Center, and as we were going back from the Hurricane Center to the airport, I mean, there were lines at Costco a mile long. I mean, and so, you know, I don't really like the fact that people just stay in line, but it just shows you people are heeding the call to be prepared. And I would also know we're in contact with companies like Publix and Walmart, just stressing the importance of having restocking the shelves, and I think they've been great to work with. But you also can get some of this stuff on Amazon. They're still delivering, and hopefully will over the next several days. So just do what you can to be prepared. If you are in an area like parts of Jacksonville that have experienced flooding in these past storms, just prepare that if the storm does impact this area, that you're going to see water, you're going to see flooding, and take the necessary precautions. Understand where shelters are in your area. Understand where evacuation routes are available to you. You know, I was speaking with the mayor about whether there's going to be evacuations here, and I think because the storm slowed down, those orders, if they come, you know, may not come until Saturday maybe, and that's fine because you want to make the best decision you can, but if there's an evacuation order issued, heed your local officials, you know, especially somebody like the mayor who's been through this. You know, he's not going to do that lightly. I mean, if he's doing that because that's the way to protect people's mm-hmm. safety. And you know, we will work with the Florida Department of Transportation so that if an evacuation's ordered, you know, we'll waive the tolls, we'll do what we need to do on the roadways to make that effective. Just a couple updates on some of the other things that we're doing. You know, we have 15 urban search and rescue teams that are on standby for deployment. We have some school closures that have already been announced, primarily in Central Florida, Daytona State College, Valencia College, and UCF. They're going to be closed Friday through Tuesday. And then the Department of Education in Florida held a hurricane preparedness conference call with superintendents and with our state college and university presidents to receive an update on their hurricane preparedness plans. And on Florida Department of Education's website, you know, we will be posting the school closures as any additional ones are announced. Florida Department of Economic Opportunity is extending the deadline for local governments to submit applications for the $85 million Rebuild Florida Infrastructure Repair Program. And then Visit Florida, I mentioned earlier today, they have activated the Expedia Visit Florida hotel accommodation web portal to support folks who are in mandatory evacuation zones. And it's www.expedia.com/Florida. We appreciate them offering that. In terms of our nursing homes and generators, our Agency of Healthcare Administration has activated the emergency status system for healthcare facilities statewide. We have already ordered 9 emergency generators of various types, which will be staged in a forward operating area. These generators are mobilizing now, and will have a variety of uses, including stormwater pumps, traffic lights, and providing power for various emergency response needs. Information about nursing homes and assisted living facilities generator status can be found on the new webpage, fl-generator.com. And as you know, there was recent legal requirements that the legislature did for these generators to be put in the nursing homes. You can go to any county, click on it, and you'll see which nursing homes have it, which nursing homes still haven't complied or in the process of complying. And so that's a tool that the local folks here can use, but also anyone that may have loved ones in that. But I would also just say with respect to nursing homes, we saw with the case recently being brought down in South Florida, you know, if you're somebody that has vulnerable folks under your care, you know, you're responsible for having a plan and executing a plan. And if you have a hurricane, a strong Category 4 hurricane bearing down on the state, and you know your area could be impacted by that, you need to have a plan. You need to know what you're going to do if power is lost, and you need to protect the people whose care you're maintaining. And if you don't do that, I think what this case showed is that you will be held accountable. We're working closely with the fuel industry to ensure an adequate fuel supply. You've seen some long lines in different parts of the state. Some of the gas stations have run out. There is a lot of fuel in Florida. It's just when a gas station runs out, the trucks have to bring it in from the port. So my emergency order allows there to be more capacity for fuel delivery. And so we have waived the hours of service and truck waits for fuel trucks. We're also requesting surrounding states such as Alabama and Georgia to waive requirements as well while trucks move throughout the southeast in preparation for Hurricane Dorian. And we're working with industry partners to identify additional resources if necessary, including truck staff, etc., to distribute more fuel throughout the states. And so we want to make sure that we're working well. Obviously, the Attorney General is going to be monitoring any places in terms of price gouging. We've seen some reports of that, not just with fuel, but with water. And, you know, that's not consistent with the law, and you will be held accountable. We have over 800,000 gallons of water in the state and 1.8 million meals ready for distribution. States also ordered an additional 200,000 gallons of water in preparation for the storm. So we're basically over 1 million gallons of water that will be available. And we've also pre-deployed 860,000 bottles of water in counties in preparation for the hurricane. I've also asked, obviously with these storms, shore erosion is an issue. We saw it with Hurricane Matthew right here off the coast in northeast Florida. So I have my chief resiliency officer working so that we can mitigate those effects. If there's things we can do on the front end, but certainly on the back end, we're very sensitive to the damage that can cause. I'm going to turn it over to the mayor. I want to thank our Lieutenant Governor Jeanette Nunez for being here. So Mayor, take it away.
Thanks. Thank you, Governor. I think it's important that the people of Jacksonville see the relationship with our city and our governor and his team. You know, if we get an evacuation situation, the partnership will help us with how roads are handled and managed. If we get into where we're having to shut down bridges and work with our mayors at the beaches and then reopen bridges, access to funding, I mean, just all the stuff that goes into this that unfortunately we've been through twice. So, Governor, we're grateful that you're here. We're grateful for your team. We're ready, and I'll close with this. I'm going to keep reiterating this. Be prepared. Know your zone. You don't want to be under an evacuation order, scrambling to figure out your zone. So go to jacksready.com or download the app, put your address in, and know the zone you live in. We'll take questions. Thank you.
I got a question about municipal utilities. You mentioned it in the previous stop. JEA obviously is a municipal utility. What kind of support do you have for JEA and others, and are you expecting better or worse performance regarding recovery than, say, Irma and Matthew, those storms that knocked out power here for over a week in some places?
Well, we can let Jay, you want to come and speak to that? I mean, we had a great discussion. I stressed to him the state's interest in making sure that, we're marshaling the necessary resources so that when the storm passes, we can go in and restore power very quickly. That's something that Florida Power and Light is very, very keyed in on. And I was impressed with the actions that have been taken here. I'll let him fill you in on it. But yes, I'm concerned about some of the municipal utilities just because some of the examples we had in the past. I mean, when you had, I think he's gonna tell you that they've done good steps. So I think that's good. But it's a situation where sometimes you need to have more resources. Florida Power and Light, they're part of a very big company, so they have an ability to kind of do that. So go ahead, why doesn't JEA tell you what they're doing?
So JEA is fully prepared to deal with the storm. We are the experts. We have taken a number of lessons learned from Matthew and Irma, especially on the water side with regards to having backup power generation for many of our lift stations. We've got a majority of our flow that is now covered by fixed generation. We also have 100-plus backup generators for the rest of the county and our four counties that we serve. From an electrical perspective, we have called on mutual aid from Texas. And we have them ready to stand by for additional resources. We also have coordinated with all the other IOUs and municipalities throughout the state of Florida. We are prepared. We encourage all of our customers to be prepared, as the governor and the mayor had articulated. I'm sure FPL is just as prepared as JEA, and we're both very good at utilities. Thank you.
And I would just say, one thing to just point out is, as they're making the preparations is, there's a high degree of uncertainty with the forecast. I think you've definitely seen over the last 12 to 24 hours, the plots moving in a direction to take it more a north turn up the East Coast, impacting this area. Doesn't mean the other parts of the state are not also at risk, but we're seeing that movement, and I think that's something that you're cognizant of because Matthew did not even directly hit Florida. It skirted the coast, and that caused a lot of problems. I mean, there was a lot of water. We did have power outages, and so we're sensitive to that. Another question?
Governor, you were talking a little bit about evacuations possibly Saturday if it comes about. What about on 95? I mean, that's an area that's going to impact us here. Thoughts of making changes there, maybe one way, allowing the shoulder. What are you thinking ahead about on possible evacuations?
Well, one, I'd say a couple things. The mayor made the decision in conjunction with the university officials to move the football game to Tallahassee. And I think that was, from an economic perspective, probably not a great thing for the city, but I think from a safety perspective was the right thing to do. And I think his concern was really well-founded that, do you want football traffic to be mixed in if you end up having people to evacuate from some of the areas in Jacksonville? So I think that was a good decision. I think that'll be helpful. In terms of our traffic, the FDOT secretary, I've instructed him, whatever options are on the table, people say do one way or not, I certainly don't rule that out. I think it would depend on the number of evacuees, the way the storm's coming, but obviously we want options on the table so that if there's an evacuation order rendered, that people have the ability to effectively evacuate. I would also say this, in just talking with some folks down in Brevard County, there are some areas, depending on how the storm affects certain places, where you will not be told to evacuate and you will probably be encouraged to stay put. So heed those requests as well. I mean, no local official can force you to stay. I mean, if you leave, you leave. But if you're not in one of those evacuation zones, there may be good reason why the local officials think it would be worse for you to try to evacuate. So just keep that in mind as well, because if you're safer staying at home, you know, that's the most important thing. But also, if you end up staying at home when you should be at home, then this way we have less cars on the road. So, but in terms of what we'll do, all those options are on the table. We want it to be done as effectively as possible if it does come to that.
We have time for one more. Anyone?
All right, thanks, guys. Appreciate it.